Hey, good day everyone. My name is Billy McHale and I am a member and moderator with the Project Avalon Forum. Today is Sunday the 3rd of November 2019 and at this moment I am on the small island of Gozo after having been on the island of Malta for a month. We had a gathering on Malta and we visited the ancient temples and there were members from Project Avalon. And it was a great success. I then came to Gozo, to the small coastal town of Marzafon, to relax for a week before I headed back home to Scotland. 2 weeks later, and I am still here. It was here that I had the pleasure of a chance meeting with Lini Radic. Lini is, among other things, a journalist, and we are here to introduce you to her latest book, Sirius, the Star of the Maltese Temple. So good day, Lini, and thank you for being with us. Can you first of all give us some background about yourself, where you're from and your profession, and how you first became interested in the ancient megalithic temples of Malta and Gozo? Then take us on a journey of how you were inspired to research and write your latest book, which was published last year in 2018. Sirius, the Star of the Maltese Temples.
Thank you, Billy. It is a pleasure to have been invited to do this interview with you. This was a real surprise that we met at all last week. So, I first came to the Maltese Islands 29 years ago. And that was after I have lived in Berlin several years prior to the fall of the wall. I am from the Netherlands, Holland, as you would prefer to call it, I think, and by profession I am a translator, nowadays also a court translator, and in the old times a book translator. I was invited by the Maltese authors, some of them, to go over to Malta and they would look after me. So they took me all over the island, and I loved it straight away. As you well know, that either you love Malta or you hate it. Yeah. I was one of the victims who loved it. I had the luxury of being in Malta for 6 weeks, which gave me the opportunity to explore the island. And I would never have thought that I was going to explore the island as extensively as I was then doing. Ended up doing. I passed in Valletta the archaeological museum, and what I saw inside I'd never seen before, and I didn't know about it. So I was very intrigued, and very much so. So I started walking the countryside, if that is the right expression, buying a guidebook and looking for all the temple ruins. Once I had seen in the museum what fantastic stuff and artifacts and altars and most curious figurines had originally been found inside these buildings. So I went back to Berlin, and the whole city was then in turmoil. It had completely changed. Mm-hmm. And like many of my German friends, even we decided that our time in Berlin had finished. Yeah. And then I had two options, either to go back to Holland or go to Malta, where I was offered a job in tourism, which is not my profession. Mm-hmm. But they needed me with all the languages I have at my command to work as an interpreter. And I decided to go to Malta out of curiosity and fascination, actually. So I worked as a translator in tourism, as an interpreter, and I made it my specialization to point out to people how many of these sites there actually were.
What year would this be now?
We're speaking now of the year 1990, which is 29 years ago.
Okay.
And I stayed in Mulla for 6 years, which gave me ample time to pursue what was already then more than a hobby, but a true fascination. Mm-hmm. It had captured me.
Became a passion.
It became a passion, yes. Still, I found Ugolini in the Royal Library in Holland, mm-hmm. which is a miracle in itself.
Yeah.
And that puts you into a whole different world. So from Holland, I started giving talks and lectures about the Maltese temples in Germany for the Anthroposophical Society. By that time, after having moved back to Holland, I had been asked by the Anthroposophical Society of Holland to translate several series of Rudolf Steiner's lectures.
Mm-hmm. Like from German to English?
From German, so from the language Steiner has written his books in, into Dutch.
Into Dutch, okay.
Yes. Yeah. And that made me involved with the Anthroposophical Society, which was a lovely experience.
Mm-hmm.
And through the Studienhaus Röspe in Sauerland in Germany, so the study center of one of the study centers of the Anthroposophs in Germany, I gave lectures about the Maltese temple culture, and from these lectures and for groups were formed who wanted to travel with me to Malta, and they saw my deep connection with this culture and suggested that I should do a book.
Well, thank you for that, Lenny. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your the little book you wrote on the archaeological walks around Gozo, which was published in 2009, and how it was received by the locals here.
That was only a little book, which I did out of pure joy. It was in the middle of my research for my larger book, which would appear much later. So in the meantime, I had gathered so much knowledge about the prehistoric sites of the Maltese Islands, including those of Gozo, that I knew how hard it was for people to find these places if they were not acquainted with the features and the advantages and disadvantages of Gozo's countryside, and which I happen to find so lovely that I spend most of my time in Gozo when I do research or when I want to write. And during my walks, I discovered features which were very hard to find. I mentioned one of them, which is the Rasiluvadia Punic Temple, which is the picture on the cover of my first edition of the book. And that gave me the idea of doing a book which would be about how to find all these places in Gozo, prehistoric, mind you. And that I also knew that there are far more than any of the tourists are aware of, because they are being taken on a day trip to Gigantia, to the Azure Window, when it was still there, and to a lunch, and to the Citadel, and that's practically it.
Yeah.
And even the locals wouldn't know how to find, for instance, this Punic temple, if they are even aware of it. Then it was announced that the year 2009 would be free of any hunting. And in all my years in Malta and Gozo, I had never experienced that before. So I felt so delighted that you could walk the countryside completely free and free of fear. In January, February, and I happened to have enough time to spend here several months, and I decided out to honor the country and for pure happiness that there was no hunting and trapping, I decided to do a present for everybody and to do everybody a favor. And I did the book within 3 months. I found the sites I needed to include in my walks. It consists of 4 walks, which have different level of difficulty, I would say. Some of them are very easy, and only one of them is a bit challenging due to the length of it, not to any height. And it was received very well.
So in your book, Sirius, the Star of the Most Used Temples, there's a foreword by a man named Giovanni Bonello. And I was fascinated by his foreword and the way he writes. And I'm going to read just the first part. The first 4 words is, "This is a disturbing book. The author defines its contents as controversial and its conclusions as surprising. I judge it to be far, but far more than that. It is disruptive of accepting wisdom and unsettles all we believe we knew about the origin of man in Malta." So, could you tell me a little bit about Giovanni, please?
Giovanni himself is an extraordinary man. He is a judge, and he is a human rights judge. He was delegated by Malta, I think 10 years ago, for several years to the European Union to be part of the Human Rights Commission. Mm-hmm. And he had always opinions of his own. He had very humane judgments about cases that other judges would dismiss, and he would always plea for, you know, the unprivileged. And he's just a very good person, plus an extraordinarily accomplished writer. He's an art expert, and he publishes himself book after book about Maltese modern art. And he is a historian in the sense that he publishes many books about the history of the knights, but with a very special view on the history of them. He works out the history from a perspective that nobody else has ever thought would exist. So he is always full of surprises. He has a crisp pen. He is a very extraordinarily good writer and accomplished writer, and he has a good heart.
Okay. So when he says this is a disturbing book, could you elaborate on what he meant by that?
Well, he may very well be one of the few people whose judgment is complete about this book. First of all, he's an expert about the history of his own country. He is 80 years of age. That means he has lived through times that many people do not remember, but he has experienced them himself. And his father was also a famous personality. So through his father and his own personal experiences, he is able to judge what the valid points are I make in my book. And I cannot speak for him himself. It's better you ask him, but I suppose that what he found valuable is that I dare to bring up details about Maltese political history that usually Maltese or certainly foreigners reluctantly touch on. Plus, I dug out aspects of the archaeological history, which I think even the young generation of archaeologists would never have heard about.
Mm-hmm. How many temples have been discovered in Malta and Gozo?
In the course of time, it were altogether 66, which have been recorded in the authoritative survey by John D. Evans in 1971. That's the year it was published, and it is the authority on the temple sites since then. So in my book, I published a map which my designer designed especially for my book, which indicate all the temple sites, of which half were still in existence when I walked the countryside to find the remnants, and most of them are still visible. Then about 20 temples have their ground plans intact and have been recorded. And these ground plans were very important for establishing ultimately the reason of the many temples that have been built in the islands.
Mm-hmm. So Lenny, the result of your book is that the temples are much older than the accepted dates of today. And could you expand on that a little bit, please, sir?
Well, yes. I wasn't going to write any revolutionary book. So my intention was, when I started on this project, to write a book about all the riddles and the mysteries around the Maltese temples, and also debates which I had witnessed during the 6 years that I lived in Malta, and when I could read in the newspapers the controversies surrounding the dates, first of all, of the arrival of the first human beings in the Maltese Islands. No more and no less was my intention. It was only by asking the questions I asked that, by coincidence, more or less, the last question I was going to investigate and trying to answer in my book happened to be also to give me the answer to all the other questions too. And I will explain more in detail now to you how that came about. It started all quite innocently by being flabbergasted by one book, and I need to mention the title, Dossier Malta, which was written by Anton Mifsud and published in 1995 in its original edition, which opened my eyes to the quite likely possibility that the habitation of Malta by humans was dated to a much earlier time period than was accepted by archaeology. The extraordinary young date that archaeology gives to the first Maltese arriving in Malta is 5200 BC, when they were supposed to have come by boat together with a handful of cattle from Sicily to Malta and arrived here and settled as farmers. And then after they lived here for 1,000 years or so, all of a sudden, out of the blue, for no particular reason at all, began building these huge temples. And according to the official narrative, they built the Gigantea temple, which is the largest of all of them, first of all. And then when Mifsud's book was published, who pointed to evidence that there in the Ardalan cave, between the bones of Pleistocene or Paleolithic animals, had also been found human teeth that could possibly and most likely would date to that same period. And the revelations that Mifsud made in his book were based on his own investigation as a medical doctor who went especially to the Museum of Natural History in London to investigate his these teeth. That first of all, they had never been at all been dated by radiocarbon dating, which is the most important technique for any material which contains radioactive carbon, which means for all materials which have been once alive, like plants, teeth, trees, charcoal, etc., etc. These teeth have never been radiocarbon dated, but originally they were found to be Paleolithic, judged by the state they were in, by the state of fossilization. They were fossils, mm-hmm. and very grey. You can still see two of them, I think, in the Adelaar Museum, if I'm not mistaken, and if they haven't taken them to Udine, I'm not sure about that. At any rate, three were found, two are still extant, in existence, and they then, after the war, were dated by a dating technique which was fashionable at the time, but is outdated now, and it was decided that these teeth were not Paleolithic, but Neolithic. They are the main evidence of Paleolithic man in Malta, the main physical evidence. And the author of this book, Dossier Malta, shows that there was purpose in not investigating further. Meanwhile, he has updated this book. It is available freely online as a PDF. Search the title, mm-hmm. Dossier Malta, and the author, and you find the 2010 version in which he offers to pay for this radiocarbon dating investigation himself. It has never happened.
Okay.
This was not the reason I wrote the book, but it made it is very convincing that they should investigate this according to the latest techniques. Then, when I started my research, I discovered something totally different, and I ended up in the same line of thinking, that something is not quite right. The archaeology started in Malta and took off at the beginning of the 20th century, first by a German investigator, Alfred Meyer, who knew the famous Arthur Evans, who had already become interested in the site of Knossos in Crete. And he came to Malta 3 years before he began his excavations in Crete. And it is quite obvious that he knew Meyer, and that they corresponded about the Maltese temples. Now, in my book, I quote passages from the research of both these gentlemen that confirm that they knew each other, and also that Meyer towed the line that Arthur Evans preferred for the interpretation of the Maltese temples. And this was that they were not Phoenician, as used to be thought in the 19th century, but they were Bronze Age. Bronze Age, but not older than the Cretan Bronze Age. They were contemporaneous with the what would later to become the palace of Knossos in Crete. And he tried to convince his readers by talking about the same cult that was going on in the Maltese temples, and that would also be found based on the finds in the Palace of Knossos. From that time onwards, the Maltese temples got tied up with Crete. Now, that is not a problem, of course, but the thing is this, that Arthur Evans made Crete into the cradle of European civilization. Mm-hmm. And it is quite obvious from my research, the details of which you will find quoted in my book, that most British archaeologists were following Arthur Evans' project in Crete and were agreed with him that the Maltese temples could not predate that civilization. And actually, Malta could not be a civilization at all, let alone predate the Cretan.
Because there were Babylonian savages.
Well, there was a problem, of course, with their interpretation, and they solved the problem by declaring the Maltese temple builders to be retarded Stone Age people who built their temples in the Bronze Age, so that they built outdated stuff, which by the look of it belonged to the Neolithic, but they were retarded. And being isolated islands, they expressed themselves with these types of building in the Bronze Age, which is a bit strange, but still nothing alarming about it, until someone came to Malta who threw another light on the whole situation. That someone is Luigi Maria Ugolini, who was a friend of the great Maltese archaeologist Temis Amid. And although Ugolini was not permitted to conduct any digs himself, he received all his information through Zamid, who introduced him to all the material in the archives of the museum, and his own, Zamid's, excavations in Tarjin were then going on. We are talking the years 1924 to 1934. Mm-hmm. And in this decade, Ugolini produced enough material to print 5 coffee table-sized books about the Maltese islands, and under the title The Cradle of Mediterranean Civilization. The first book appeared in 1935, a year before Ugolini himself passed away. And it was called Malta, Origins of Mediterranean Civilization, in which he told us that according to his investigations, being a specialist in horizon archaeology, which is the archaeology of the different levels and layers inside buildings, the Maltese temples are Neolithic, suddenly, and date back to the early Neolithic. The first expressions of them were built in 8000 before Christ, which is different from 4000. It is printed in the conclusions of Malta, Origins of European Civilization. And then, of course, all hell broke loose. I didn't know about this before until I started doing this research and found it in the papers.
So he was the first archaeologist to go further back in time, really. I know it's like his research hasn't been accepted.
No, it was not accepted even before the war, when his first book came out. Like I said, Ugolini died in 1936, and the other 4 volumes never saw the light of day. His material was stowed away in the basement of the Museum of Ethnography in the outskirts of Rome, and it was only recently rediscovered, which I will explain later on. Of course, we are hoping that the other 4 volumes, which are probably being printed, that they will ever see the light of day and we can read them, but it seems to take a very long time.
Yes.
Anyway, after the war, because of Ugolini's extensive work on the Maltese temples, a complete survey, a treasure trove of photographs, and a very, very in-depth analysis of the temple layers, resulting in this very early date. This alarmed the archaeologists who were active in Malta, the ruling establishment, and from abroad were sent in 2 very accomplished and archaeologists. One of them I have known personally, David Trump, a very pleasant man. They were sent to do what Ugolini had done, but overrule his findings, overrule his conclusions. So that's why the new survey done by John Evans came about, which is a perfect survey. But it came to the conclusion, as was wanted, that the temples were Bronze Age. And what was new then is that for the first time, it was introduced that no people had been on the island prior to the Neolithic. During Ugolini's time, it was usual to and acceptable and fully accepted that based on these Neanderthal or Paleolithic teeth. There were people in Malta during the Paleolithic age, which is the Ice Age period. Mm-hmm. And that was cut off of Malta's historic timeline after the war. And it is my personal opinion that this was done more or less intentionally.
Mm-hmm. To keep the Greek narrative.
The prevailing one.
Yeah.
Or also, I actually, to be very honest, I don't understand why. What the explanation I give, I find very likely, because I can prove it with quotations. And also I can prove that some personalities from outside Malta have had a vested interest in forgetting the name of, making the name Ugolini forgotten. Hmm. I do not want to go further into this. It may be a matter of taste, or as I personally think, it was deliberate. Hmm. Yes, to salvage the cradle of Europe. Why do I think it is deliberate? To have a cradle of civilization based in an island with a huge culture of prehistoric temples, megalithic on top of it, and very ancient, built by a community which did not wage war, of which the skeletons from the cemeteries even up to the late Neolithic do not show any sign of aggression, a community of hunter-gatherers, because that is what we're talking about when we talk about 8000 BC in the footsteps of Ugolini. Peaceful communities creating tremendous architecture and incredibly beautiful art is not what you want if you want to prove that Europe, with its own political philosophy and political bias, which is expansionist, which is not based pacifistic principles, I would submit. You do not want a cradle. You do not want the beginnings of civilization to be pacifistic.
Mm-hmm.
So what you need is a society like Crete, who were seafaring, expansionists, and they had bronze weapons, and they waged war, and they were successful, which is a picture which you need if your philosophy, which you can adhere to, which I don't, if your philosophy is that this is the ultimate goal of humanity, that by the survival of the fittest, which is the struggle for life, which implicates the vigor to create wars and overcome other people, that this in this way our society evolves to its pinnacle, which is us. This is the reason I think that they didn't like Malta, but the only reason. What other reason would that possibly be? To give megalithic civilization the primacy and the cradle of us. I wouldn't mind, but I am not. I'm not a politician.
Yeah.
But what I have discovered, and what my own work leads to concluding, is that there was a strong purpose behind the wish to place the cradle of our civilization in Greece.
Mm-hmm. So early on, you mentioned Arthur Evans. How did he become involved with the archaeology of Malta? And what influenced him to be involved?
Arthur Evans became an archaeologist after he had a career as a journalist. He had an education in Oxford as a historian, but his father was the greatest factor of influence. His father was a famous man in England. He had done great work about the Paleolithic period. He was a pioneer. He had gone to France together with his friend John Lubbock, who investigated the gravels in the north of Belgium, I think it was, or France, where the first Paleolithic tools were found. which was a revolution at the time, okay, when all Christian people still believed that the world started with the creation by God of Adam,
yes,
in 4000 BC. If you then prove that the world is much, much older, which Lubbock together with, but first of all, John Evans, Arthur, yeah, Evans' father, mm-hmm, have to be credited with. They were famous in Britain at the time. We are not so much aware of it now, but it was true. They did fantastic work.
And when I was reading the book, I saw that Lubbock was part of a club called the X Club.
Exactly. They were, Lubbock himself was a close friend of Charles Darwin, and he was a London banker, also rich. He had, out of his enthusiasm for old artifacts, mm-hmm, and old megalithic circles, he had personally bought Avebury to protect it. So he did a lot of good work, that first of all, first and foremost. Being a close friend of Darwin and an eager reader of Darwin, he noticed, as Darwin himself was very well aware of, that Darwin left off or did not continue his story of the evolution into the human evolution period. So he stopped where humans appeared. Lubbock was one of the first members of a club around Darwin who gathered around Thomas Huxley. I think it's the grandfather of Aldous Huxley. Thomas Huxley, in 1864, founded a club which was later to be named by themselves, the X Club. And they convened in London regularly between 1864 and 1893. And it was a circle of nine friends, very close friends, and they never allowed anyone else into their circles. And also they saw in secrecy, in the sense that they would not make notes of their meetings, and they would not speak to anyone outside their small circle about what was discussed.
So it seems that the present dating of the temples was a stumbling block for past researchers who were trying to connect to the orientations with celestial bodies. And to find a connection, you had to go much further back in time. You mentioned 9150 BC, which is 11,150 years ago. Is that correct?
Yes, thank you for the question, because it takes us into two different subjects. That is, first of all, we need to ask, was it legitimate for me to feel so free in the way I looked at the astronomy of the temples? And as a result of my first little booklet, The Walks on Gozo, divers came to me who had found underwater features which they thought I needed to know. So it was like it happened organically, like it was meant to happen. So I got in touch with one of the divers, which is Brian Azzopardi, who made, especially for my book, a film of the probably man-made feature inside Billinghurst Cave. Now, I need to warn the listeners who are divers not to go diving there, because it is a dangerous dive. It is only doable by technical divers and very experienced ones, because the cave is 120 meters deep inside, and it is 40 meters below sea level. So inside that cave, and at the far end of it, Brian discovered and filmed this platform. I do not say it is man-made, but it, if you look at the film, it looks like Brian is correct. And all we say is, this needs to be investigated. Should this be man-made, then this is the final and definite proof that there were people in Malta during the end of the Ice Age.
Yeah, I watched that video clip, and I see he took a square tile down and put it in the corner. Yes, it looks like 90 degrees
Yes.
Vertical.
Well, yes, first of all, the sea does not wash out straight rectangular corners.
Yeah.
And still, we need to check whether the walls have been smoothed by by hand,
yeah,
by man,
yeah,
which can easily be discovered, be
yeah.
checked. But it has never been done so far. That is one of the objects of, or features. Then another diver brought me what looks like a Paleolithic hand axe. I'm not a judge of hand axes, so I leave it to potential investigators to check.
So these are things that should be investigated.
Investigated.
Yeah.
That is all I need. I want to say. What I personally found that everybody can check is that the description by Leith Evans in his mid-1900s book, Travels to Egypt and Malta, or something of that nature. He has an extensive part in it about Malta and investigates all the cracks and the gaps and the caves and the caverns in these limestone rock. And what he finds there, this he describes so minutely that I could distill from it evidence that he stumbled upon traces of human activity, which he himself did not acknowledge with so many words. He was very cautious. But I point to that in my book. There are many more traces of evidence of human habitation way before the Neolithic, amongst others these teeth, which of course should be investigated by radiocarbon dating, and so on and so forth. Anton Mesut himself mentions a whole series of microliths, which are tiny Paleolithic and Mesolithic era tools made by men, which have been dated to the Neolithic, but should be investigated with an open mind, I would suggest. Anyway, the reason I tell you this is that all my own research and led me to think that I could feel free to try and answer the riddles surrounding the Maltese temples from an astronomical perspective, but also to be open about the dates. And I will tell you now, in a minute, what difference this makes.
Mm-hmm.
I am not the first archaeoastronomer to investigate the temples. They were measured and very accurately investigated by George Adjus and Professor Frank Ventura from the University of Malta. They had the equipment to measure the azimuths of the temples. An azimuth is nothing more and nothing less than the compass direction.
Yeah, the orientation.
The orientation of the temple to the horizon. And the azimuth is just the compass direction. There is no difference.
Mm-hmm.
So they measured the azimuths and placed them on compass rows of wind directions. And that was a very surprising outcome. They discovered by their work for the first time, published in 1980, that there are patterns of orientations, but no one orientation is the same as another. That means all temples pointed to another direction, but the shift was only slight, and the orientations clustered around southwest and southeast. And except for one, they all pointed to points on the horizon which is not being reached by the rising or setting sun.
Mm-hmm.
That means the sun comes not into the picture except for one temple.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this one temple is neither south, and it has been proven and accepted by archaeologists that this is orientated towards the rising sun of the equinoxes, which is the 21st of March and the 21st of September, when the duration of the day is the same as the length of the night. That's why equi and nox is night. The night as long as the day.
Yeah.
That is due east. Because all the temples which have been measured have the typical Maltese temple period ground plan, which is this curious clover leaf, beautiful. Oval.
Absolutely beautiful. Yeah.
Beautiful plan with a corridor straight through the middle from the apse at the back of the temple to the portal, to the entrance. Mm-hmm. That is also the middle line of the temple itself. So the axis of Nidra South points towards the sun. It's also on this diagram of temple orientations done by Ajus and Ventura. It is the only one pointing east. But it gives us the legitimate investigation route to look at the sky for an answer for all the other temple orientations.
Yes, yeah. It's also aligned with the solstices. Is that correct?
Nidra is not aligned. The alignment is to the equinox, but there is a light display inside the temple during the winter solstice and during the summer solstice as well.
And it also has door jambs, what I call door jambs, the pillars, the vertical pillars that catches the sun on the corner. Is that correct?
They are the slabs placed inside the first oval room of the temple.
Yeah.
We're talking about Nidra South all the time. So during the summer solstice, the sun rises up the hill and falls into the doorway.
Yeah.
But crossways.
Yeah.
And leaves a stripe on the slab inside the apse. So not on the doorway itself, but on a slab inside the temple.
Yeah.
And mirroring that situation is really beautiful. The winter solstice sunrise leaves an identical stripe on the opposite side.
Yeah.
It's really
amazing.
Beautiful. Yeah. So this is extraordinary. Mm-hmm. When you come to think of it, that they have designed the temple with rough stones and huge stones, and they accomplished this degree of precision. Today's architects admit that for us even it would be very difficult. So the orientation of Nidra South to the equinox, which is to the sun, makes it legitimate to look to the sky or an object in the sky for all the other temples. And I already mentioned that they were pointing not to any point on the horizon where the sun either rises or sets. So that leaves us with a problem in principle. Now, Ajus and Ventura looked at precisely this, and because they confined themselves to the dates given by archaeology of the temple period being about 4000 to 2500 BC, they looked at the stars in the southern sky, which rose in the southeast and set in the southwest, and came up with several stars which pointed or were in the range of the temple orientation. They did not find any one star which was inside of all the temple axes at some point in time. They did not find this one star because of their date, their constraint in time. And I already was convinced that I was permitted to look further. I did not know that it would answer any more questions than just, you know, that you would find maybe a star. But this is what happened. There is a movement in the sky which is called precession, which makes all the stars, which are not circumpolar stars, move slightly along the horizon when they rise and along the on the west horizon when they set. This movement is precession. It is well known, and you can look it up if you wish. It is so slow that you cannot see it with the naked eye. Every star moves in 72 years. It moves 1 centimeter along the horizon, which is hardly visible. It is hardly visible during a lifetime, but it is visible over several hundreds of years. In fact, if a given star would rise or set within focus of a temple corridor at a given time, 200 years or so later, it would be out of sight of that temple. So a new temple would have to be built. In fact, this is a principle, a method of dating a temple, or, as Arthur Ventura did, a method of finding a star if you take the dates for granted. Now, if they find several stars as candidates due to the limited dating they applied, then there is a problem. The Maltese temples are so obviously a unity. They have the same ground plan, all of them. They have the same architectural style. Even the figurines that are found in them are so obviously and recognizably Maltese. And the spirals are so perfect that you recognize that they are Maltese because they are, the reliefs are so finely chiseled. And then these were found in all of the temples practically, above ground and underground. So to ask the question, because of the unity of Maltese temple culture, it is actually needed to look at one star as a candidate for all the temples at any given point in time. So what I did was I relaxed the time. I did not constrain myself to any dictates or doctrines. So I turned it around. If you do this, and then if you find only one and not two or three, what you have then discovered is the mechanism which makes the orientations of the temples being slightly different for all the temples. And it also is a solution for the riddle why these obvious clusters of orientations, the clusters come into being because they started building a temple when that given star became visible, and they were forced to build new temples because of the movement of the star along the horizon in course of hundreds and also of thousands of years, as I found out. Mm-hmm. That is, if you accept the astronomical principle of this dating technique, if you accept that this is legitimate, which I would plea for. The reason why this is, in my view, very logical to follow is, first of all, it gives an answer to very important riddles and questions surrounding the Maltese temples. That is, it gives an answer to the question, why were there so many temples built? They had to build them, because if they want to follow the star, there was nothing else to do. That's what you do. And then you also have proven that these are temples in the sense as observatories to a star. And that it is logical then that they had a roof, which they had. That is your most important question answered, why so many temples? And then why the clusters? Yes, the mechanism that makes the stars move, the mechanism in the sky called precession, gives you these clusters. They stopped building when the star was moving into the line of sunrise, I think. I must admit that the question of why they stopped building temples in Malta has not been definitely answered, neither by me nor by anyone else.
Yeah. But they had to realign the temples as the procession.
Yes. Well, the star, and the one star, which is the candidate, is Sirius. And if you now have these gigantic temples in Malta, this huge culture, and they pointed to the brightest star of all in the sky, in the night sky, which is Sirius, then I think you are very close to the solution of all the riddles of the Maltese temples. Then you have also have found the name, or the identity at least, of the goddess of the temples, which is her representation on Earth, which in Egypt was Isis, or Sobdet, and for the Romans it was Isis. Hmm. It is a true Mediterranean solution to all the questions around the temples.
And, you know, it's a goddess that's in all the temples, you know.
In all the temples,
I'll call her Big Mama. She's
That's lovely. Have you noticed that in the museum There are two trunks of statues, remains of statues, which have smaller figures under her skirt.
No, I've not seen that, no.
Not many people see it, but I have pictures of it. If you like, I can give them to you.
Yeah. And there's one with two goddesses, like twin together.
Yeah. And these were found in what is known as the Shara Stone Circle, which was a cemetery, or the cemetery after it was an underground temple. So they were found in the sacred part of the cemetery. And it is a Maltese goddess, but then twin goddess seated on a couch. Very lovely.
Okay, yeah.
And the beauty of it is that in the Bronze Age, in Sicily, we have the double goddess of Persephone and Demeter, which are being depicted during the Bronze Age in Sicily as being twin goddesses seated. The Dea Seduta, she is sometimes single and she is sometimes double.
Okay.
So it is attractive to think that this tradition of the Dea Seduta and her double started in Malta.
Okay, and that takes you back to what year when you found that Sirius was... How far did you have to go back?
When Sirius was first seen, actually, the precession movement of a star is a movement which lasts 26,000 years. Now, half that time, the star moves from south towards east in a northerly direction, and the other half of this time period, it goes back. From the latitude of Malta, which is about 36 degrees north, to be precise, Valletta is 35.90 north, so nearly 36 latitude. On this latitude, the star Sirius would have been visible for the first time after it had been invisible for a long period.
Mm-hmm.
It came back again in its precession cycle at about 9,400 precisely south, which would be on the horizon. And because it is overlooking the sea, you would not be able to see it at that date yet.
Mm-hmm.
But it comes closer in course of the centuries.
Mm-hmm.
And I have, my computer program has given me the date of its being visible with the naked eye at about 9,150, when it would make a low arch. It would describe a low arch above the southern horizon, rising slightly east of south and setting again west of south. And it would be visible at that time. Now, precisely then, one of the smallest temple footprints, the one which is called Hajarim North, the small one, lying outside the tent, was directed precisely in that direction to the setting position of Sirius. And you know the time at which Sirius appeared, and you know the azimuth of your temple, then you know also the building date of the temple. The lovely coincidence, or the lovely picture we get now, is that they started with a very small temple, actually just a roof over their head to watch the star, which was a star which at that time was a new phenomenon, and because it was Sirius, it was an amazing sight to see.
Very bright.
They hadn't seen any brighter star. Venus is brighter, but it's not a star.
Mm-hmm.
And the moon is brighter than the sun. But they are not stars of the night sky. No.
So 9,150 BC.
Yes, that is the first temple. And then in my book I have the graph of all the temple azimuths, both to the rising and setting positions of Sirius. And they give you the timeline of all the successive temples built then accordingly to... pointing to the shifting positions of Sirius. It's absolutely lovely.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And all, you know, obviously all the dates when they were built. You know.
Yes, and amazingly, the last temple to be built is also the largest. So the last temple to be built according to the precession of Sirius is Gigantia South, which is the largest temple of any site. Mm-hmm. It's also Verhu, which is there. It's also called the Cathedral of All the Temples. That was the last we built, which sounds very, very logical that, you know, as time passed, the building skills improved. That is human experience.
And what date does that?
And that is the date which is precisely in conformity with the dates of the archaeologists, which is around 4000 BC. My date is only 150 years earlier on this time scale, that is peanuts. So my date is 4150 BC. The archaeologists say about 4000 or 3800. And they call it the oldest. In my book, Jugantia South is the youngest.
Yeah. And they were building temples for 5,000 years.
For 5,000 years.
Wow.
Well, that's what they did in Egypt, didn't they?
Yeah.
In Egypt, they built temples for 3,000 years. Mm-hmm. And we have been building Christian churches since how long?
Yeah, 2,000.
2,000 years.
Yeah.
In this connection, I would like to point out that the temple building on Maltese megalithic sites went on and on into Christian era. We know it from the site of Tasilj, which is a megalithic site. So it was started with a megalithic temple, the footprint of which is not clear because it was destroyed later on. When the Phoenicians arrived, they lovingly included the megalithic temple in their Phoenician building, which was a temple to their great goddess, Tanit. And then the Romans came and they improved on the Phoenician temple without demolishing the megalithic temple. They respected it and had a temple to one of their goddesses. And the site is now called Il Madonna Tasilj, with a chapel nearby. The whole area is called Del Imara, the shadow of the lady, in one reading.
So it's dedicated to Mary, you know, goddess.
So although the Christian tradition destroyed most of the megalithic temple remains, they continued the tradition of the mother goddess.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, in Scotland they built a lot of churches on top of the old megalithic temples on the same ground. Fascinating, absolutely fascinating. Thank you very, very much for spending time with us. Now, where would people be able to buy your book?
It's been sold in Malta, but for people from Britain can order it via amazon.co.uk. And there is also a web shop on my website, which is www.sirius-malta.com.
Okay.
You will find there a web shop, as I said, and also a contact form. And I would be very pleased if people who have read my book would also comment or contact.
And get some feedback.
Feedback. It would be feel very
fantastic.
Very
I mean, I've got a few pages to go myself, but once I started, I just couldn't put it down. It was absolutely fascinating, full of information, and it's an easy read as well. So thank you very, very much for your time and your research, and I'm sure people are going to love this. So listen, whoever's listening, please buy this and comment on it. Lenny is used to having criticism. If any researchers out there disagree with her findings, then go do the search, do the research. You've set the stage. So they just have to follow up and do the same research. And they can tell you how your work doesn't work. If they want, prove you wrong. And I'm sure they won't prove you wrong at all.
I look forward to a fascinating discussion.
Yeah.
And I thank you very much for this lovely interview, Billy. It was a pleasure talking to you.
And you. Thank you so much.